Back by popular demand. So following the Deconstructor Fun series, I'm sitting down with powerful Eric Suford and very knowledgeable Evgeny Perez. So Eric from Mobile Dev Memo and Evgeny, of course, from Iron Source to discuss everything on iOS 14 for the third time. I think that we're going to have a recurrent series all the way until iOS 15 rolls out. But we're going to chat about now about the practicalities of the new privacy rules. We're going to dive into some implications and analyze what's really changed so far and what hasn't. So welcome, gentlemen.
Hey, Miska.
All right, let's kick off with the first thing that I want to talk about, and that is the apocalypse that we were talking about a year ago. So iOS 14, it has arrived. I think we're in like version 14.6, if I'm correct, or 14.5. Mm-hmm. And 6. Yeah, 4.6. I knew it. My phone updated today. So after a month, it seems like everything is kind of okay. There's no apocalypse. So I'm asking you guys, like, did we overestimate the impact, and or is it being delayed? And the adoption rate is about 50%, and there's still no apocalypse. At the same time, Apple is really pushing the privacy front. So I don't know what I'm talking about. Eric Suford, would you like to start?
Yeah, well, first that you have to kind of keep in mind that the adoption rate is a little bit less than 50% right now, but it only really started ticking up last week. So it was like hovering around 20% for all of 14.5, or it kind of maxed out at about 20% through the 14.5 series, because there was 14.5 and 14.5.1. And it seemed that Apple just wasn't pushing it. Usually they do like an automatic, they push an automatic update to people's phones, and they hadn't done that. So they were testing some things, is my belief. They made a pretty substantive change to the privacy threshold, to the sort of privacy threshold setting for SK Ad Network postbacks. So that was something that I think they were monitoring, and they decided to change through that process. But it once they released 14.6, they did push the automatic update. And so that's when you started seeing the adoption rate curve, shoot up and the sort of the inflect. So yeah, we're seeing like 40-ish% adoption right now, which then, sort of percolates throughout the app ecosystem a little bit more slowly than that, because people have to actually see the prompt and opt in or out. Opt-ins are roughly kind of, I think, where people thought they would be, in the 10-20% range for, broadly speaking. Apocalypse, I think it depends on what you expected to see. You are seeing CPMs drop on no IDFA traffic. You are seeing them spike on IDFA traffic, and you are seeing CPMs spike on Android. So, I mean, there definitely has been, there have been changes throughout the ecosystem. Now, apocalypse is going to be a little bit longer term to witness. Like, how does this shake out, and how does this affect companies commercially? It's still pretty early, and again, we're not even at half or majority adoption. So, I mean, it's just it was never going to be like a snap of the fingers type thing. Which, I did, I wrote a bunch of posts where I sort of invoked the Thanos analogy, but it was never going to be like that in terms of just the impact. Now, Apple did do the Thanos thing in terms of saying like, hey, we unilaterally decide at this moment in time that ATT is a thing, but it's going to take sort of like a month or 2 months or, 2 quarters, let's say, to fully play out where we get like visibility into what the impact was.
Yeah, it makes sense. So a lot of the things, so Apple not pushing it yet, but assuming that once they cross that 50%, 60%, then they will be implementing a lot of these practices more heavily. And then the privacy has been definitely a big thing. The opt-in, as expected, crossing about maximum of 20%, and the CPMs. The CPM is an interesting thing. So dropping down on iOS, and it was already quite high, and going up on Android. Evgeny, what are your takeaways?
Yeah, I think into your the first question, the timing of the apocalypse was assuming ATT will hit back then very quickly in September. I mean, like the first time we talked was a couple of weeks before DAB was planned. And then the assumption was that once ATT kicks in terms of the technical enforcement of ATT, where IDFA is only available if users opt in terms of the market readiness back then, If Apple would have really released it as is in 14.0, I think that would have been quite painful in terms of the market, the industries, and the understanding of this change. We're here now, a year later. Apple pushed this change, 14.5, 14.5.1, 14.6, only last couple of days. Until that point, it was only the early adopters that's kind of opted in by themselves. So the first ATT OS version was released, I think April 26th, roughly. But these are the kind of users that we've seen, and it didn't impact the industry as much. But I agree that it's going to impact. We're going to see the impact in the next couple of weeks. But the market readiness is still, I think, a very big challenge. I think in this case, we underestimated how much this is of a huge paradigm shift for the market in terms of the market forces and the readiness of the developers themselves.
How do you measure the readiness? Like, is it you know, you talking to heads of UA and you know, the marketing teams of different you know, biggest publishers and kind of hearing what their plans are, or like, what is the measurement of readiness?
Yeah, I think so. So there's another level up session that we're doing as part of this event that we're going to be showing some of these things. And basically, we're seeing just the adoption of SKA network as a whole, the adoption of conversion values, how many developers really have implemented. And I'm not even talking about those that have implemented in a way that is truly valuable and actionable at scale. I think in this case, perhaps Apple has underestimated how big of a change this is. I think the last events from the latest WWDC show how serious they are on privacy. And also in terms of the privacy relay, which there's a lot to talk about, but their latest changes on the privacy thresholds of SKA network, and in general, the strides they're making on SKA network to make it a better measurement alternative. I think we're getting there, but it's very hard to measure truly the readiness of the market. Looking at the top spenders, you see the readiness across the board, from being as ready as possible to not being ready at all. Also very limited with the upper bound of the readiness of each platform, I would say.
Eric, do you have something to add?
Well, that was I agree 100%. Like, people were just not ready. That's part of there's a couple like confounding factors here. One is that it was rolled out slowly. And so like, if you weren't ready, it was like, well, whatever. I mean, iOS 14 is, you know, it's whatever. It's 10 or 15% of traffic, right? So it didn't really matter that much. Another thing was that the MMPs are still fingerprinting. They're still doing fingerprinting exactly as they were doing it before. And so, you know, you kind of fell back to having, you know, these fingerprinted IDs that made it seem as if everything was fine, right? Now, fingerprinting is a pretty, you know, I did this podcast series called ATT 1 month in, and I had Alex Bauer from Branch on, and he made a really good point. Like, fingerprinting is really good at telling you, hey, this was the device that clicked your ad. And then they installed. It's not very good at doing that, you know, with precision, right? It's really good at just telling you like, we filled this field and there's not blank, but it's really bad at being able to do that with like max precision, right? It just sort of falls back to whoever it thinks it was. So, you know, I think that'll be the next sort of shoe to drop here, is like when Apple starts, and I think they'll be doing that very soon, but when Apple starts enforcing fingerprinting, you know, restrictions, then we'll see, you know, real impact here. But yeah, the platforms weren't ready either. I mean, it took Facebook like a week or two after iOS 14.5 was live to the public to even roll out their like SKA network documentation. So they weren't ready, you know, with the rollout of ATT, or the, you know, making it mandatory. So I mean, everyone was kind of caught, you know, on the back of their feet. But I mean, this will play out over the next month-ish. 2 to 3 months, you know, maybe 6 months. And I think that's when everyone will be able to take stock. And I think that's what a lot of companies were waiting to see what happened. Like, will an ad tech company come up with a solution? Will this just be delayed again? Mm-hmm. You know, without, there was like a, almost like a chicken and egg kind of waiting game that people were playing. It's like, well, I can't build any solutions until we see the data. But you know, we're not gonna have any data until we have a solution. So, you know, people just were sort of like hoping that ad tech companies would come to the rescue, and none of them have really done that in terms of, you know, the kind of support ecosystem.
Well, it makes sense. I mean, this is a giant change. And if you're head of UA at a big publisher, you're of course calling your MMPs, and they're telling you, because it's their core business, that, hey, we got this. We got the smartest minds in the smartest cities all thinking about this. And if the shoe hasn't dropped on fingerprinting, it's kind of okay-ish. And that kind of leads to the second topic that I wanted to talk about, which is Android. Because a lot of the publishers and a lot of MMPs and different type of service providers who I talk to look at Android as the kind of like the primary platform these days for new launches and for optimizing creatives naturally. And that's the kind of we've seen the CPMs go up on Android. And now recently Google announced that they're also introducing this opt-out option in about late 2021, so late this year. So what I wanted to hear from you guys is, like, how do you feel about Google acting as the sort of optimization platform for marketing at the moment? And do you think that Google will do with GAID same as Apple did with the IDFA? So Evgeny, should we start with you?
Sure. So I think what's interesting here is that it's, in general, when you look at Google's behavior as you know, the store, the Play Store, Google as the marketing platform, how they engage with ATT over the last year, and they responded actually on as a platform to ATT with not engaging with that, but on the other side, the Play Store will adopt similar nutrition labels later this year as well, similar to Apple's change from last year. And also their change to GAID is actually almost the same as Apple did with iOS 10 5 years ago, where Apple, and this limit ad tracking was already out for 4 years, starting iOS 6. iOS 10, basically, Apple decided to enforce technically, as if someone is opting out of ad tracking, Apple will zero those device IDs. Google was not the case only until now, and basically, I think at this point, Google are aligning with what Apple did on iOS 10. The alternative, though, of for deterministic measurement on Google still exists, which is the refer. So effectively, you can still you're still able to measure those users that are coming in the deterministically, but you don't have access to their device identifier to retarget them if they don't want to. Until this point in time, it was technically possible for those that tried. So I think that's the change. It's still not at all on the same level level that Apple had made a year ago. Not even close.
It's not the same thing at all. Like that, I don't know. You'll still be able to do attribution for installs with the refer, right? Yep. Even with Google's LAT turned on. So it's even kind of weaker than Apple's, but yep, you won't be able to do the full event stream, right? Which is the real power of the device ID, was you get the event stream and then the platforms aggregate those events on their own platform in their own data environment, and they use that for targeting. Right, that's the real value of the device ID. It wasn't necessarily like install attribution. Yes, of course, but you need that. But you know, an SK ad network gives that to you, right? Like, you'll get exact device or install attribution at the campaign level, at least. But what the power of the device ID was event aggregation and doing targeting on the platform, and you're still going to lose that with this Google LAT setting. But you know, it took years for that to reach kind of like a meaningful percentage on iOS. I mean, that was announced in 2016, right? And like 2020-ish, the LAT rate in the US is like 40%, right? So it took a long time. That develops over time. And you know, the same thing will happen. So it's not the sort of dramatic, aggressive, impact of ATT, right? It's gonna be a much slower process of seeing that number tick up over time.
How valid it is to use the data that comes from Android to validate the type of creatives you should be using and the type of marketing strategies you should be using on iOS? Like how well they correlate?
It's tough because it's dependent on the context, right? For some apps, it's fine. Like they're very similar, right? Some apps, there's a big difference. And it's just, it would just be context dependent. It's hard to say, broadly that yes, you can do creative testing on Android, and then just sort of borrow those learnings, and apply them to iOS. It's just hard to say.
So, okay, let me be more granular. I'll give you an example. Let's say I'm a big hyper-casual publisher and the smallest changes in the creative can have a huge effect on the CPM of my game and the actual business case of my game that is being launched. So just the smallest, tiniest thing of like, what color the rocket is in my playable ad or in the video ad. And now that is taken away on the iOS, or it's just not the same with the creative optimization. If I do it on Android, is it applicable on iOS? Like just your hunch,
For hyper casual, it's probably fine. My guess is that they don't see big differentiation between, the creative performance, across like a batch of creatives between Android and iOS. But for other categories, it's different, right? And like I would imagine, hyper casual is probably unique there. And then maybe other types of casual games, it's the same. But for other types of apps, and especially like more utility and subscription apps, my sense is that there is a big difference, and it's going to be hard to just do testing on Android and apply the learnings to iOS.
Evgeny, is it generally so that the top creatives are the same? Like the hero creatives, are they usually the same for both platforms, or is there a platform specific hero creative?
Generally, so yes. Dan has a great session about creative in this context, and I think he's going to be showing some data broken down by genres, but it's not 100% yes. So I think it's not only genre, I think it's also it's something that needs to be validated, but I assume that for specific markets, the gap between Android users and iOS users and the popular apps within those markets differ, and it creates a different performance, I want to say, across those devices. But in generally speaking, yes. And obviously, iOS 14 introduces a big challenge on testing those creatives on many fronts. But it's better than not testing at all. Definitely something that you can test a couple of concepts, pick the best two winners, and then test them on iOS. Probably something that is worthwhile pursuing that.
Is this a win for Google? I mean, a lot of companies that I talk to my own strategies are Google first nowadays. Like just allows better testing. Like that's the primary platform. And then of course iOS is extremely important, but it's not the first because of, the restrictions.
Could be. I mean, it's probably, it depends on how you think that this impacts Apple, right? I mean, I've been making the case for a long time that, since this was announced, that this is basically like a market grab on Apple's part. And so in that sense, it could be bad for Google. If only because Apple gets to exert much more control over iOS and, essentially is able to exercise like total like sort of editorial, dictatorial control on that ecosystem, then also consolidate a lot more, of sort of power, with respect to, with respect to driving users into its own services, right? And also differentiates itself from Android in being like the sort of more privacy protective, platform, and just, generates goodwill there and drives hardware sales, then yeah, that's probably good for Apple and bad for Android. I think if you look at this with the narrow scope of Google Play versus App Store revenues, then yeah, it's good for Google. But the bigger picture, I think Apple is trying to shift a lot more market power in its favor. and just wrap its arms around the iOS ecosystem, you know, kind of in a much more commanding way. And so that I don't know that them doing that is necessarily bad for Google per se, but it's very good for Apple.
Okay, that's a more well thought out macro picture of things. I wanted to talk about IDFV, so basically cross promotion. And IDFV, I mean, it provides a means to run cross promotional iOS campaigns, which include users who have opted out without relying on that fingerprinting. But it kind of looks like IDFV is not enough, especially since publishers kind of has to register all the companies behind one vendor. And we've seen that not all of the companies and not all of the big publishers are willing to do that for various reasons. So even though I'm not going to name anybody, but you can actually just go in and look at the app and see if they have the same vendor ID or not. So what's the optimal way to set up cross promotion 2021? Is it to buy ad networks like Zynga did, or to buy mediation platforms like AppLovin? And of course, AppLovin has an ad network as well. So I guess this is a question about content fortresses, but I'll let Evgeny to start off with this because Eric will talk a long time.
I mean, the if you look at the last year, there's been some moves on this front of from the publishing perspective, kind of putting more and more titles under one umbrella. To I think it's a strategy to potentially facilitate that and create that. I don't know if it's the content fortress, but technically to be able to kind of keep running as you were used to with this mechanism for the purposes of, you know, tracking users across apps owned by the same company, basically, which is compliant with ADD. But like you said, there's not been that many moves on that front. I haven't seen yet any big success stories there. Obviously, this was one of the first things that we discussed around a year ago. But realistically speaking, this is probably not the in the top three solutions to the new challenge, I want to say. It is probably helpful, especially for those that are cross-promo heavy and they have a very big portfolio. I actually have seen more M&A for different genres than similar genres in the space. And I think there's some value there, but probably not something that is pivotal to your business.
Eric?
Yeah. So the IDFV is problematic, right? So for one, you've got to transfer an ad. If you want to have the benefit of the IDFV and apply it to existing users, you can't, right? You just can't. Like if I buy a company and I transfer their app to my developer account, the IDFVs of the existing users don't necessarily change to reflect the new company's IDFV schema or whatever. So that's one problem. The second problem is not all apps can even be transferred. There are cases that where if you've used like certain Apple services, your app just can't ever be transferred. And so that means you have to like kind of unpublish and republish it, which again, you just lose the existing user base. So that's problematic. And you know, the thing is, you just don't need to do that. It's a process, right? It takes time to do that, and you don't need to. The idea of a content fortress is not necessarily doing cross promotion, but it's I wrap my arms around all of the first party data, and I do it in such a way that anything that I was trying to target to before is now happening in my first party environment, and so I can still target to that, right? And so when I wrote the Content Fortresses article, I looked at Zynga, right? And I said, hey, Zynga's talking about doing this, and they ended up doing it. And I talked about AppLovin, and they, you know, they were doing it as well with buying, you know, an identity system, with buying an attribution system. And so it's more about, hey, I have all these properties, and they're not under one publisher account. They might not even all be apps, but since they're all mine, I can gather all the data, collect it in a first party way, have a data environment that I own completely. And then anything I do with that is my data, and I can serve ads as a result of that. I can do sort of personalization as a result of that. All the things that ATT prevents you from doing, and I'm not saying ATT doesn't prevent personalization, I'm just drawing an example, but all the things that ATT prevents you from doing, which is basically advertising tracking, I can do that because it's not tracking, because that's not how Apple defines tracking. So that's the idea of a content fortress. Now that requires all this data to be first party. It doesn't necessarily require ad tech. But ad tech makes it a lot easier, right? So Zynga buys Sharpboost, and now they're able to use all the data that Chartboost has and all the logic that they've built over time to optimally serve ads within their own portfolio, which is vast, right? It's big. And that becomes sort of like a mini environment that looks like, you know, a mini ecosystem.
Zynga do it. We've seen, of course, AppLovin do it. But now that I'm thinking about like other top 10 publishers, they haven't been shopping around for, I mean, they might have been, but they haven't closed any deals for different ad networks.
Let's see how it pans out for those that did, I think. And there's not that many that are left on the shelf, I guess. So if it does pan out, I think that's going to be very interesting to witness how the market reacts to that. But it's very hard to say. Yeah, it's all on paper, I think, at this stage.
Yeah, I think it's all on paper in a sense, but you know, this is not a playbook that's new, right? I mean, these cross promotion systems have existed for a long time, and it makes total sense that you'd want to double down on that, if only because acquiring a user is going to get more expensive, and so you need to get more LTV out of the same user, right? And there's a couple ways to do that, like you increase the sort of monetization in a given app, or you chain a couple apps together and get more monetization that way. But it's just the only thing that's changed is that playbook's been implemented by a number of companies. What's changed is that, you know, the cost of users or the value is going to go down depending on how you think about it. And so if I can't, you know, before it didn't make sense to invest in all this cross promo infra when I could just go to the well whenever I wanted to and buy users cheaply on IronSource or wherever, on a relative basis to now, it's like, well, okay, these users are going to be less relevant, less targeted. On Facebook, for instance, and so I'm gonna get less value out of these users when I buy them, and so therefore I need to find a way to sort of increase that value across multiple apps. That's something that people have been doing for a long time.
Makes sense. So let's end this one with predictions. So what do you think the market impacts of iOS 14 will have cost by the time iOS 15 hits the devices or by the end of the year? Will we see more M&A? Will we see decrease or rise in CPM trends? Will there be a decline of hyper casual games, rise of mixed media models, return of licensed games, gradual fall of whale driven monetization, more, you know, cross platform games? Like what do you guys predict inside, let's say inside a year, like a year from now? Evgeny?
I'll go first, I guess. I think the adoption of SKAD Network is gonna grow significantly. I think the latest changes, and I think only in the last couple of days we'll see, you know, the next couple of days we'll see the impact of ATT at scale. But implementing SKAD Network and kind of polishing it to be a good alternative for measurement as best as possible, especially with the latest enhancement, will yield, the understanding and the acceptance of this new paradigm shift on this new framework. I think the impact when you break down the market, the lack of IDFA, which we're gonna see in the next couple of days, will impact some platforms much more than others. Some platforms are not used at all to not seeing IDFAs, the bigger ones. Some have been running on 40, 50% limit ad tracking for the last 3-4 years. So I think the impact will differ, but then that will impact the ability to monetize and acquire users. I think the distribution of the pie will change between the platforms, but also between the different developers. I think for hyper casual, I don't know if we're all in agreement on this point, but actually looking at, you know, assuming SK Network becomes the alternative for measurement, the way it's designed gives actually a lot of power to hyper casual developers. On the privacy threshold front, with the way the hyper casual funnel, how it works, the amount of user we're talking about, the scale, it's very easy for a hyper-casual publisher to be seen by an advertiser as a valid source app that is driving certain engagement rather than smaller apps. Could be big apps, but in terms of revenue, but small on the DAU. And on the other side, the capability to measure quality for hyper-casual is by far much easier compared to many other, especially IAP-driven developers. And this gives them the advantage to monetize as best as possible, given all the new challenges, the headwind, but also to quickly measure and adapt and operate profitably. Might change the other optimizations and on the monetization strategy. Like Eric said, there's might be new challenges and new opportunities to monetize better. But at the end of the day, SK Network provides a valid alternative, especially for hyper casual, despite the potential drops on the CPMs that we're already seeing so far.
Eric.
I mean, it's hard to say. There's a lot of like countervailing forces here. My sense is that all that of what you said is just true, but it doesn't really matter because the hyper casual are just buying from each other, right? I mean, that's what 60%, 70% of their traffic is other hyper casual apps that have been acquired. And so like, if that only is supported by other apps buying in, right? And like, I think the delay is going to cause a lot of problems with like trust of buying hyper casual inventory in an aggregated way. And then the lack of IDFA just doesn't allow you to target specific users anymore. And so like, yeah, all that stuff around hyper casuals buying from each other, that maybe would become even more robust, right? But when the sort of bottom drops out of like, well, the actual CPM is supported by people buying aggregated traffic. And now I don't know that they'd want to do that if there's a big delay and more importantly, buying specific IDFAs. Well, then that just is no longer tenable, right? But like, I mean, again, hyper casual, skews way heavily towards Android, right? In terms of DAU. Now revenue, it's more balanced, but DAU, it scales to Android. So, I mean, I don't know that the whole model just instantly sort of like evaporates, but I think hyper casual is facing real risk on iOS. My sense is that this M&A frenzy is going to continue, right? Like I think, I wrote about it in the post, like that's almost a year old now, the Ragnarok post on Deconstructor of Fun. But this is just another sort of like evolutionary moment in mobile gaming. And, this is just going to, that just drives M&A. And we've seen a ton of it already. Stillfront just acquired another studio today, right? I mean, they've been on a buying spree. And
I think it was just the game. I think they just
It was just a game, yeah. But I think you're going to see much more of that. I think a lot of like Yevgeny said. I mean, almost all the independent ad networks have already been bought, right? There's just basically one big one left. A lot of the DSPs are getting picked up now. I think you see teams spinning up to meet demand here, to just get bought up to service to service some company's internal ad ops team. But I think there's going to be a lot more M&A. I think that the timeline here is like, you had a lot of people waking up to this last June, but it was some tiny percentage of the overall market. And then, you look at the number of people that were even prepared when iOS 14.5 launched, and it was very, very small proportion. And then, so now I think people are starting to get, to get alarmed by this, right? Like a month in or 6 weeks in. And so my sense is that you have people that missed their first quarter and weren't alarmed by this, and they had kind of convinced themselves that this is no big deal because they were incentivized to do that, and their partners were incentivized to tell them that's no big deal. And they miss a quarter, and they say, "Okay, well, it's just growing pains, or it's just sort of like short-term volatility." And they miss a second quarter, and they say, "Oh no, we never built any tech for this. We never prepared, and now we've got to buy up companies to help us navigate this." So I think you're going to see like people, starting like people that were waiting for a second delay, and they realize, okay, there's no second delay, I better start work on this. And then people are just like, now we're going to wait it out. And then after they miss two quarters, they're gonna say, okay, now we have to get ready, and they're gonna just buy a company. So I think you see the kind of cascade of M&A and the cascade of just people being worried about this increases rather than decreases. I don't think the vast majority of people were unprepared for iOS 14.5, and now like they're just starting to fortify themselves against this.
All right, lots to chew on this. Pro hyper casual against hyper casual, but definitely things are getting more intense, and the M&A is getting more frenzier. And of course, there's a ton of money in the market, so that fuels the M&A even further. Gentlemen, appreciate all the knowledge. We could continue this for hours, but let's end it for now. So thank you so much for joining the conversation.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Miska. Nice to chat with you again, Evgeny.
Thanks, Eric. Till next time.